As part of the Thomas Family Worm Week, I'm going to tell you about the European worms that are causing havoc to North American soils. Worms are known to be incredibly important to the health of our soils. They open up pores within the soil, which improves soil aeration and allows water and soluble nutrients to reach plant roots. They decompose organic material, such as plant and leaf litter and dung. Nutrients like phosphorus and nitrogen become more readily available to plants after digestion by earthworms and excreted in earthworm casts. Many animals also depend on worms for food. They are a major food source for moles, badgers, hedgehogs and foxes. There are also many smaller animals that feed on earthworms, such as beetles and centipedes. At least that is the case in Europe, but in North America it is a different story. The species of earthworms that once lived 45 degrees north of the equator were eliminated by glaciers during the last ice age. As a result, northern ecosystems, including their soils, vegetation and carbon pools, have developed in the absence of earthworms. It is left to microbes and other soil-dwelling organisms such as mites, nematodes, millipedes and fungi to break down organic matter in these northern forests. As a consequence, the leaf litter layer that builds up on the forest floor breaks down very slowly. But in the 18th century, European settlers arrived along with the invasive European worms. And more recently, Asian species have made an appearance in these soils. And it is not just North America. Earthworm species have also been recorded in various parts of the Arctic biome, such as Russia and Fennoscandia. It is estimated that of the 182 species of earthworms present in Canada and the United States, 60% come from Europe and Asia. In most northern North American gardens, all the worms are invasive species. But does this actually matter? Well, it turns out that it does. Invasive worms have been found in North America's boreal forest, which spans from Alaska to Newfoundland. The North American boreal forest is the largest intact forest left on Earth, with around 1.2 million acres. Canada is home to the majority of the boreal forest, with 85%, but Alaska also contains an extensive expanse throughout its interior. Globally, the boreal forests store more carbon than the world's tropical and temperate forests combined. One of the main characteristics of a boreal forest is an especially thick layer of leaf litter, which can be up to 10 centimeters thick in sites dominated by sugar maples. As a result of this, the species of tree that grow in these forests are especially adapted to deep leaf litter. Unfortunately, the invasive earthworms break down plant matter faster, reducing the thickness of this leaf litter. It is estimated that in a forest without earthworms, it takes about 5 years for a maple leaf to disappear completely. In a forest with these invasive earthworms, it takes less than 2 years. The disappearance of leaf litter leaves tree roots exposed to the air and vulnerable to drought and sun damage, which weakens the tree's structure. The characteristics of the soil in these forests can also be completely changed. There are changes in pH, texture, and density of the soil, as well as nutrient enrichment, and the native species are not used to these different conditions, leaving the soil environment inhospitable to them and allowing non-native plants to thrive. An example of this is the sugar maple, the young saplings of which struggle to survive. Instead, the Norway maple, which evolved alongside earthworms, is doing well and may well become the dominant tree. Earthworms also consume, within 1 year, up to a quarter of a tree's rootlets. They also break up the mycorrhizal relationship that roots have with the beneficial fungi in the soil, increasing the stress to a native tree. The effect on the microbes found in the forest and animals such as arthropods and salamanders has also been disastrous. There has also been a decline in the abundance of some insects and mammals living in the undergrowth, as well as ground nesting forest birds. Another problem is that the boreal forests are known to be a very important terrestrial reservoir of carbon. The thick spongy layer of rotting leaves, mosses and fallen wood that lie on top of the mineral soil contain most of the carbon stored in the boreal soil. When the earthworms break down this layer, carbon is released into the atmosphere. The potential effects of the earthworms on the carbon stored in the forest floor has been modelled, and it was found that around 50 to 94% of the forest floor's carbon stock was reduced after 125 years, with most of the reduction occurring in the first 35 to 40 years, which means that the boreal forests that have been invaded by earthworms are emitting more carbon dioxide into the atmosphere than they are absorbing. At the moment, it is estimated that about 10% of the North American boreal forest currently has earthworms, and that by 2050, most of the forest will be invaded. So if the models are correct, invasive earthworms will be inadvertently contributing to climate change over the next 30 years. There is also a more recent invasion of Asian worms, which are even more destructive than European worms. These worms were introduced to the southeastern United States in the 19th century, but have only started spreading north in the last 15 years. They are now present in all northern eastern US states and have recently crossed the border into Ontario. These are known as jumping worms due to their jumping and thrashing movement when they are disturbed. The problem with these worms is that they grow larger and recycle nutrients even faster than European worms. They also live in dense colonies, with sometimes more than 100 individuals per meter square of ground. They don't dig tunnels or feed underground, but remain near the top of the soil in the top few centimeters, rapidly feeding on leaf litter. The degradation of the litter is so rapid that the nutrients released cannot all be absorbed by the soil and plant roots. This results in very nutrient-poor upper layers of soil, the compaction of the lower layers, and the pollution by nitrogen and phosphorus of nearby bodies of water. The jumping worms also consume plant seeds, reducing the number and diversity of native plant species that can grow. The worms also cover the soil surface with dry, grainy pellet-like castings, which destabilize soils and prevent seeds from sprouting. Left to their own devices, earthworms can only spread about 10 meters per year, but they are spreading a lot faster than this due to human activity. They can be transported in tire treads and by boats, and inadvertently by gardeners. They have also been dumped by anglers when left over as bait. Once they invade an area, they are difficult to remove, so restricting their introduction into an area in the first place is vital to stop their spread further north. Gardeners can help by avoiding moving earthworms into forested areas, and anglers can avoid releasing their unused worms into the wild. Until I read about this, I had assumed that earthworms were present in all the soils around the world, and I had no idea that they could be so detrimental to the environment, that is, to an environment that they have not evolved alongside. I thank my brother Mark and his wife Chris, who live in Canada, for putting me onto this story. I hope that a combination of education to raise awareness of this problem and the precautions that could be put in place will prevent the earthworms from moving even further north. If you enjoyed this video, then please like, subscribe, and share with your like-minded friends.